हेलो।
गुड इवनिंग सर, निखिल है सर।
हाँ या सो आई थिंक आई विल ओपन द कॉइन राइट।
हाँ यस सर, यू कैन ओपन सर।
कैन यू सी दिस?
हाँ आई कैन सी सर, यू कैन जस्ट ओपन द पावर पॉइंट सर एंड
या
देन यू सी वेदर इट्स।
हाउ इट वर्क्स। ഇവനെ ഇത് മാറ്റണം, എനേബിൾ കണ്ടന്റ് ആക്കണം, എനേബിൾ കണ്ടന്റ്.
യു ക്യാൻ ഇനേബിൾ സർ.
ഓക്കെ
സർ, വൺ മോർ തിങ്, ദാറ്റ് മിനി സ്ക്രീൻ യു ക്യാൻ സീ നോ സർ, ദാറ്റ്
മീറ്റിംഗ് ഇൻ ജനറൽ. യാ
യാ യു ക്യാൻ can just click on that next option, you know, sir, upper
So I can remove that. Okay,
yes, that's
okay.
Yes.
Fine. So tell me when you are ready.
Sir, we are ready, sir. I think 52 people have joined, so
okay,
we can start,
no.
Sir.
Super. I don't know anything. So Nikhil and his friends, there is one book called Swami and His Friends by R.K. Narayanan. Something like that. Nikhil and His Friends. So they will have interpretation of echocardiography and color Doppler in congenital heart disease. So basically what we are doing is seeing with sound. And on your right hand side, on the bottom, you will see a very famous iconic picture, which is of course the sunken Titanic. And you, some of you at least may be wondering why Titanic is important to echocardiography in congenital heart disease. This of course is an echo, which is a nymph in the Greek mythology, and Milton has written about her, very captivating young lady. And now coming back to business, the new OED, that is Oxford English Dictionary, defines echo as a sound or a series of sound caused by the reflection of sound waves from a surface back to the source. So that is what is called as an echo in plain English terms. And if you look at the history of echo, I think it starts from Pythagoras, 6th century BC, that is around 24, 26, 25 centuries ago. And the concept of this something beyond the sound was thought of. Then in the late 800s, people realized that the bats fly mainly because of flapping their wings and having their echo, picking up the echo, and because they are blind and they move because of the echo physiology. And then of course the piezoelectric effect was in 1880, one century later, which is very important in echocardiographic sending and receiving signals. And finally, three major events in the 20th century led to what we call as an echocardiography. And probably the first major event was sinking of Titanic in 1912, because it was considered the unsinkable ship, and it crashed on a less than visible iceberg, and the Western psyche was shattered, because how can you can have a Titanic sink? And then in the First World War and in the Second World War, these two major world wars were there, very important. But so to begin with, people wanted to pick up icebergs, because as you know, 90% of icebergs are hidden under the sea. And if you miss the iceberg, you will have a problem of sinking of various ships, and including Titanic. So people wanted to do something to pick up icebergs. And then, so people thought of something called sonar, which we pick up icebergs. Then in the Second World War, the killer ships were from Germany. In the Second World War, they are called U-boats, and U-boats played havoc on the English ships, and people wanted something to pick up these U-boats. And to pick up U-boats, I think the sonar was again further refined, and there was a sort of a balance between Germany and England in the naval battle because of this sonar. Then after every war, the major things which we do in the war for a negative purpose will have a good thing, for example, nuclear energy. Similar, I think this sonar was later on used for picking up structures inside the body, what we call as an ultrasound. And then this ultrasound, I think, basically was finally fine-tuned into an echocardiography. And these two gentlemen from Lund University, Sweden, Hertz and Edler, was responsible for the first echocardiographic machine. And of course, you know, the sound for human ear is between 20 and 20,000 CPS, whereas ultrasound is more than 20,000. And according to Perloff, the diagnostic sentinel for congenital heart disease is echocardiography. So it has been a long journey, let's say a sort of an odyssey, from Titanic sinking to sonar, from sonar to ultrasound, and then from ultrasound to the modern echocardiography. So as far as a congenital heart disease is suspected, you have a pediatrician picking up a possible congenital heart disease, and you have the pediatric cardiologist doing an echo, and you make a diagnosis, and that patient will go either for surgery or for intervention or for pharmacological management. And as you know, just like our Sherlock Holmes, it looks at heart structural aspect, functional aspect, and of course the hemodynamic aspects of heart and the great vessels. And we have two major areas of anatomy, that is M mode and 2D, and physiology, which is Doppler and color Doppler. But you must remember that ultimately echocardiography in congenital heart disease is primarily founded on the foundation of 2D echocardiography. Any student learning, whether it be a cardiologist or a technician learning congenital heart disease echo, is basically we should be thorough in 2D echocardiography. The rest will come later, and that will be very simple. So don't bother about the Doppler, M mode, etc. Very much you concentrate on having good images. That's all. But what is important in congenital heart disease, especially in a newborn baby? And of course, we know we have four modes: M mode followed by 2D Doppler and color Doppler. And we all are aware of the standard views: parasternal long axis view, parasternal short axis view, and an apical four chamber, which are very popular among adult cardiologists. Whereas the subcostal, this is mostly liked by the pediatricians, and suprasternal, of course, both by the pediatric as well as adult cardiologists. And of course, other what we call as unconventional, let's say, views. Now the prologue, basically, any congenital heart disease could be seen with sound, which could be very trivial, which could be minor, which could be significant, or which could be critical. And we have to categorize, once you do an echo, you have to categorize them into a trivial, mild, moderate, or a severe lesion. And then you decide whether this is going for either a surgical intervention or a real catheter intervention. So we should have a surgical point of view and an interventional point of view when you do an echocardiography. And regarding the interventional point of view in many of the congenital aortic heart disease, I will not delve too much on this because Dr. Shivashankaran will later on enthrall you on this procedure and assessment of this heart disease for a potential intervention. And I think if you have an adult person coming to you for a routine echo, basically we have a standard approach by starting a parasternal long axis, etc. Whereas in pediatrics, I think it is the segmental approach which is very important in assessing whether there is a congenital heart disease. And if that congenital heart disease happens to be an aortic or cyanotic, what do you call as a hypoxemic congenital heart disease. Then there are two very, very important terms when you see a small infant with that. Because many, I know that many of the residents, even final year residents in DM cardiology, DNP cardiology, are a little hesitant to approach a very small baby. But you should remember, there should be an anticipatory or a deductive echo. Because as you go along a segment, you should know what to expect. For example, you have a good four chamber view in a very small infant. And if you find a small LA and a large RA, you should think, are we dealing with a TAPVC? Suppose you have a newborn in a preterm baby in the nursery with a large LA and a largish left ventricle, should think, okay, are we dealing with a significant patent ductus arteriosus? Whenever you have a newborn baby and you can see two leaflets only in the aortic valve, you should think, especially with the LV dysfunction, it is not the bicuspid aortic valve which is causing a problem. It could be a critical coarctation of aorta. And any infant with a LVH in echocardiography, concentric LVH, you should think of either a coarctation or aortic stenosis, some of which we'll discuss. And qualitative differentials also is very important. For example, if you diagnose a small subpulmonic VSD versus a small muscular VSD, it makes a lot of difference to the parents. Why? Because small muscular VSDs will almost invariably close, whereas small subpulmonic VSD will never close, and some of them may require intervention surgery because they can develop AR. So that's a big difference. Clinically, they will only have a very short murmur. Symptoms, something like that, trivial pulmonary valve stenosis versus bicuspid aortic valve with trivial AS. Why? Because trivial pulmonary valve stenosis hardly ever progresses, whereas bicuspid aortic valve can progress to severe AS, which may need intervention. So this is a qualitative differential when you see the same defect in a different location, either on the right or on the left. And very importantly, that standard views are less meaningful, especially in malposition and a malformed heart. And basically again and again, get a good 2D imaging, and you should answer queries rather than routine viewing. You see, are there four chambers? Okay, so four chambers means there is no single ventricle, there is no single atrium, something good. Or am I seeing a large LA? Okay, so that means there cannot be TAPVC, because TAPVC is a small LA, something like that. So you continue, ask questions silently and answer in a segmental approach. And this is the most important approach, which I call a figure of eight approach. There are 8 points to be asked and answered. And why segmental anatomy? Because cardiac anatomy is segmental and sequential, and there is a minimal chance of missing lesions if you go by that. And it has, of course, as you know, very strong anatomical, pathological, and surgical basis also for the segment. And it is particularly most useful in a likely complex congenital, neonate and infant malposition, and again adult congenital who are blue, which are likely to be very, very complex conditions. You know the segmental approach, that is, you start with the thoracoabdominal situs, the location of the heart, whether on the left or on the right, look at the atria, look at the atrioventricular connection, you look at the ventricles, look at the outflow of the ventricle and ventriculo-arterial connection, and of course the great vessels. This is what I call as a figure of eight look principle. And some people have demonstrated another very interesting view, that is heart as a house model, which I thought was very, 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 very attractive hypothesis. That is, atria can be considered as a ground floor, ventricles can be considered as the second story, what we call as the first flow. Great vessels can be the top flow, and the AV connections, VA connections could be like staircases and doors. So you look at the ground floor, you look at the second story, top floor, staircases, doors, etc. And then you see whether there is a leak, there is a block or something like that. You make a reasonably good diagnosis of a congenital heart disease. And the best bargain you should know for an infant, for a segmental approach, of course, best is subcostal. And then you have an apical four chamber view and the parasternal short axis. These are the key to a segmental approach. and we will start with this. First, for example, you do a subcostal or an apical four chamber view, and you can find the heart usually on the left side, sometimes in the middle, rarely on the right side. And then, of course, when the heart is on the right side, you have to decide whether it's a situs, solitus, or inversus, which we'll discuss a little later. So whenever you have a suspected dextrocardia, begin at the subcostal view and apical view. And if it is a dextro-post heart, which is not a true dextrocardia, most cardiac structures are to the right, slightly vertical position, do not align towards the right. Alignment of the axis is normal, which is apex is still to the left. The whole structure may be somewhere towards the right, but the apex would be basically what you call as the base to apex is to the left, which you know it is due to a dextro post heart. As a true dextrocardia, most cardiac structures to the right, alignment of axis is abnormal, and then you look at the subcostal, especially to look for the situs, that is solitus. It's wrong spelling, sorry for that. And situs solitus and situs inversus. So that is the first one. So you will start with the atrial situs and the location. And once you do that, you naturally along with that, what is the venous entry, pulmonary venous entry and systemic venous entry. And then what is the number, size, identity, function and orientation of the ventricles. And what is the atrioventricular connection? What is the great vessel identity? Very important, identifying great vessel and orientation. What is the ventriculo-arterial connection? And what about the presence and direction of intracardiac shunt? And what about the presence of a location and severity of this? So this is why I said these are all questions in your mind which should be answered properly. Then you will make a reasonably good diagnosis of a congenital heart disease. We will start with the situs. Suppose it is a heart which is on the left side. So basically the simple thing is that in a subcostal view, as you will see later, the IVC will be to the right of the spine, aorta will be to the left of the spine, which means situs solitus, whereas IVC on the left and the aorta on this. I think I know it is very basic, but I think to start with, we should have very clear thing. That is why I am saying this. I am not underestimating your ability to do a segmental approach, but I think it is part of the drill. And then what happens is that sometimes you will find you have the spine, the white thing, of course, and both IVC and the aorta will be on one side of the spine, either on the right or on the left. Then you call it as a situs ambiguus or isomerism. Both will be either on the right side or on the left side. And then very important is IVC. You have to pick up the IVC, and there's a chamber into which the suprahepatic IVC drains is the right atrium. So right atrium gets the first shot. So the other atrium is the left atrium. So primarily you are identifying the right atrium because that is the chamber into which IVC drains, and the other atrium has to be left atrium. As you can see here, subcostal view, the spine is there, and as you can see, this is the spine, this is the aorta, and this is the inferior vena cava and the liver. So it is a situs solitus, and this is the, you are tracing in a subcostal view, you are tracing IVC into a chamber, and that chamber has to be right atrium. If that is right atrium, the other atrium has to be left atrium. But you can also see the pulmonary veins normally draining into LA, but problem is that you can have, of course, TAPVC. So, but generally, most of the conditions will also corroborate that this is LA because of the entry of the pulmonary vein. So, how do you identify IVC, which is smaller and expands with inspiration? Blood flow velocity is on the lower side, whereas the aorta is pulsatile and it synchronous with the apex beat, which you can easily pick up. And you cannot trust SVC because some complex congenital heart disease, SVC can drain either into the LA or into the RA, or there can be a left SVC also. So SVC is not the stable thing. The dependable is the inferior vena cava. So as you can see here on your left hand side, there is a spine, which is, this is the spine, and you are on the on your left hand side, that is patient's right hand side is the IVC, and on the left is an aorta. Both are anterior to the spine, so it is a situs solitus. Whereas on your left hand panel, the B panel, you will find aorta is to the right and IVC is to the left, which is situs inversus, very important. And now we will find another very, very interesting phenomenon, that you have the spine in the middle and both aorta and IVC are one side, either on the left side or on the right side. So it is a situs ambiguous. This is the very important, very, very important view for, this is for assessment of the situs. Then, so you are committed to the sites, location of the heart, levocardia or dextrocardia, you are committed on the situs. And then we must not forget the pulmonary venous drainage, because majority you will have a normal pulmonary venous drainage. Sometimes you will have a partially anomalous pulmonary venous drainage in a sinus venosus AST in 85% to 90%, and you can have a hemi anomalous pulmonary venous connection in a Schmidt-Ahr syndrome, and of course totally anomalous pulmonary venous drainage. These are the four possibilities on echocardiography. Never forget to assess the pulmonary vein, because many congenital echo, as you sometimes miss this, you take it very casually and you will miss a pulmonary venous drainage abnormality. And for example, in the lower half, you can see a LA behind that, there is some chamber, so it suggests that there is something abnormal. And on the top, you can see a huge right atrium and a very smallish left atrium, which will give you a suggestion that am I dealing with a TAP VC. Now the next thing is chamber morphology, that is the atria and the ventricle. You can have a pathological experience, you have surgical experience, you can think of a eustachian valve, fossa valis flap, appendage, all these things are important, but they are mostly important in angiocardiography and less important in transthoracic echocardiography. And we should be also able to find out the number, the size, the identity, the orientation on ventricles, also two ventricles or a single ventricle, relative size of an integrity of a two ventricles, which is very important for the surgeon. And if at all there is only one ventricle, what is the morphological ventricle, RV or LV? That is also important. So the simple things which we look, of course, is the tricuspid valve. The tricuspid valve, by definition, is nearer to the cardiac chamber, and it has multiple caudal attachments. And then the other valve is, so everywhere right is first decided. So tricuspid valve is decided and the other valve is the mitral valve. And the trabeculations can be smooth in the LV, mainly look at the apex, and RV it can be rough. Probably the most useful at this point would be a location of the tricuspid valve, as you can see on your left hand side very clearly. The one valve which is closer to the apex should be the right, the tricuspid valve, and the chamber into which the tricuspid valve drains has to be a right ventricle. So other chamber has to be the left ventricle. And then you have the five chamber view also, where you get a aorta also, which is also very useful in assessing aortic valves and various other things. Then ventricle identification can also be by mitral morphology, moderator band. Moderator band is very useful sometimes, because suppose you have an atrioventricular septal defect, a complete AV canal defect with two AV valves, what will happen is both the AV valves will be attached at the same level. And in inlet VSD also, both the valves will be attached at the same level. And if you have only one AV valve, how can you decide whether which valve is more apical? It is difficult. There, the moderator band becomes very important. So people can ask you in a segmental echocardiography, when does moderator band become more useful in this particular situation? As you can see here, this is a moderator band, which will tell you that is the right ventricle. So basically, I always feel that AV valve attachment and the moderator band tells you, plus, of course, the trabeculations will tell you at which ventricle. And so the ultimate thing is, these are the three most useful points for you: relative insertion of tricuspid valve and mitral valve, moderator band, which identifies the right ventricle, and of course trabeculations at the apex of the both the chambers. Then sometimes you will find only one ventricle, which is called univentricular heart by Anderson, and Americans call them as a double inlet into the left ventricle or a double inlet into the right ventricle, but ultimately they mean the same thing. And this one ventricle predominantly can be LV type in 80% and RV type in 20%. So that is the single ventricle has to be identified. And what happens that is that there will be two atria, and these two atria can enter into a single ventricle by two valves or by a single valve. Sometimes you have only one atrium connecting to the single ventricle. And of course, the single ventricle, as I told you, can be an LV type or an RV type or indeterminate type. That is also possible. This is actually only a single atrium entering into a single ventricle by a single AV valve. It's the extreme form of a single ventricle. Then asymmetry of the ventricle is important. For example, a large PDA, an abnormal volume overload of left ventricle. Large RV, an abnormal volume overload of the right ventricle, means a TAPVC or an ASD. A atretic AV valve, mitral atresia, tricuspid atresia. Hypoplastic ventricle on the right side in a tricuspid atresia. All this has to be assessed. The asymmetry is very, very important. And then you will find a connection between the atrium and the ventricle. That is called AV valves. Normally, you expect two patent valves in the apical four-chamber view. Sometimes one valve can be imperforate, so you call it as atresia. Sometimes you will have only one valve, which we call as a common valve. And sometimes there can be a straddling of the valve of interventricular septum. Then you call it as a straddling AV valve. So you have to identify the right atrium, left atrium. You identify the right ventricle and the left ventricle, and see whether there is an atrioventricular concordance or atrioventricular discordance. Very, very important. This you will find the right atrium is on right side, but what happens is the leaflet, which is more towards the apex, is on your right hand side, which means that is entering into the RV. So LA to RV, RA to LV. So it is a AV discordance, very important, which means usually it will be a VA discordance, what we call as an LTJ, which we will discuss little later. Now, there are four terminologies, that is the great vessel orientation and identity. For example, normally related great arteries. Many you report in the echocardiography that NRGA, you should know that both vessels, aorta and the pulmonary artery, should cross each other on anterior tilting. Aorta is posterior and to the right, and pulmonary artery is anterior and to the left, the standard thing. Suppose you have a transposition of great vessels. Both vessels are parallel to each other. Aorta is anterior and to the right. In an LTGA, aorta is anterior and to the left, naturally. And a double outlet right ventricle, both great vessels are parallel and they are side by side. So this is very important. See, for example, if you find on an apical four-chamber view or a subcostal view, you can see aorta, some vessel coming from the left ventricle towards one side, another vessel crossing that in an anterior plane, which is the pulmonary artery, you know that this cannot be TGA, this cannot be LTGA, this cannot be DORV. So when you commit NRGA in an echocardiography, you are committing that three major congenital complex heart disease are absent. Very, very important, this crossing of the great vessels in a four-chamber view or a subcostal view. So this is this usual thing which we are, remember, aorta in the central and you have the pulmonary artery dividing. And this is NRGA on your left hand side. And here you see TGA, you will find aorta is anterior, pulmonary artery is just behind the aorta. This is a transposition. You can see A, what happens is that aorta is anterior and to the right, PA is posterior. Whereas the second group, aorta, is definitely anterior and to the left most likely in LTGA, whereas on the C you will have both parallel. It's most likely going to be a double outlet right ventricle, most likely, because ultimately the diagnosis of double outlet right ventricle or LTGA and DTGA is not made on this particular relationship. It is made on AV concordance, VA concordance, and the great vessels. But this will help you in confirming the diagnosis. Now, perhaps a very, very great difficulty for a beginner in a newborn is the great vessels. PA is a bifurcating or a flaring vessel, whereas aorta is an arching vessel. And this can be viewed very well in the subcostal view. Apical, I always, people generally think that the parasternal short axis is very good for this, but I always feel that the subcostal and the apical four chamber in a small infant is much better than the parasternal short axis view in deciding which vessel is which and which is it coming from. So then you decide whether there is an what you call as ventriculo-arterial concordance or ventriculo-arterial discordance. You will find here both aorta is coming from the anterior ventricle and PA is coming from the posterior ventricle. So this has to be a transposition of the great arteries, about which we will discuss a little more. Then we come to the VA connection, ventricle to aortic connection. There can be only one valve. One valve will be atretic, like an aortic valve or a pulmonary valve atresia. There can be only one outlet, for example, a truncus arteriosus. Then you can have a VA discordance, but patent, like in the TGA. Then you can have a VA concordance patent, that is actually normal. Because these are the four patterns you would expect this. I trust that you will go back to these slides sometime later, go through it again. Then again, then only you will realize the possible permutations and combination of a segmental approach. And you know very well ventricular outlet can be a double outlet right ventricle, double outlet left ventricle also is possible. And you have single outlet. When you see that is the point. When you see only one outlet for both ventricles, you should think of first truncus, second pulmonary atresia with a VST, because you don't see the pulmonary arteries which are very small, and of course aortic atresia. Why? You don't see the aorta because they are very small. The so-called within inverted comma single outlet means need not be always truncus arteriosus. It can be a pulmonary atresia or a pulmonary aortic atresia. And then it's the same thing. Only one great vessel. You do a small baby, you find only one great vessel, no other valves, no other great vessel is seen. Very difficult to see the semilunar valves elsewhere. So you think of three conditions. One is pulmonary atresia, another is truncus arteriosus, and third, of course, is the hypoplastic left heart syndrome. And I tell you, sometimes it is very difficult to distinguish between a pulmonary atresia with a VSD and truncus, because both will have a large VSD. Both will have one great vessel coming out seeing. For example, aorta will be huge in a pulmonary atresia and the truncus will look like an aorta. So it is very difficult sometimes to make out between pulmonary atresia and truncus. We will see a little later. And then, of course, the intracardiac shunt, if any, because, you know, if you have a cyanotic heart disease, the shunt will be naturally from right to left. Whereas if it is a simple lesion, you will have a left-right shunting, which can be assessed by color flow mapping, Doppler, and contrast echocardiography. And is there an obstruction on the right side or on the left side? And if it is a congenital cyanotic heart disease, very important for the surgeon. That is, am I dealing with PA situation or PAH situation? Because, for example, you have a single ventricle with a PA situation, things are okay. You can have some time to do a surgery. Whereas with PAH situation, the ultimate aim is to do a Fontan. If PAH persists, you cannot do a Fontan. So you have to do something to reduce the PAH by a banding. So any cyanotic congenital heart disease, you have to make sure by an echocardiography, am I dealing with significant pulmonary stenosis or am I dealing with the pulmonary hypertension? Because the management, the timing, everything will, and the prognosis also will depend upon your decision. and sometimes you may need a contrast echo for a suspected pulmonary AV fistula and an Eisenmenger, especially PDA Eisenmenger. And now the practical thing, for example, how to catch hold of a pulmonary atresia, because you find one big vessel and you don't see another vessel very promptly, and you will find continuous flow on color Doppler and a large aorta. Think of a pulmonary atresia, and a so-called single large aorta is a large VSD, and there is an aortic regurgitation within inverted comma. Truncus has to be thought of. Huge PA, small aorta, root very small, less than 4 millimeter. You think of a hypoplastic left heart syndrome. And now there are issues in this segmental approach. For example, ground floor, our major problem is identification of the pulmonary vein. Then if you pick up a TAPVC, sometimes it can be mixed TAPVC, is very important for the surgeon. And interrupted IVC, for example, in an isomerism, and you miss a simple sinus venous race, you find you look little foolish after missing a sinus venous ASD, but many of us, including me, have missed a sinus venous ASD. Then the second story and the staircase, the concordance, the AV valve, univentricular heart, all these things sometimes can be difficult. And all this missing a coarctation is very important. And you should look at the pulmonary bed, whether it is protected or not protected, which means that if you have a single univentricular heart, you have to make sure that the pulmonary artery bed is protected by pulmonary stenosis. If there is a gradient across the RV outflow or pulmonary flow is more than 4 meters per second, the velocity is more than 4 meters per second, you can be sure that the pulmonary bed is protected, and he could be or should be a candidate for a future Glenn followed by a completion of a TCPC, otherwise called the Fontan procedure. And the lesion which can be easily missed is a TAPVC, TGA, because TGA is a very interesting thing. We'll come to that later. LTGA is another problem. Tail of two twists, coarctation, you miss if you don't do proper suprasternal view, because many times you see so many cases continuously in a small baby, and once in a while you say, okay, coarctation. I mean, you have a very casual approach to suprasternal view, and that is the one situation you will miss the coarctation, which I also committed such a folly at some point of time in my career. So now that is the segmental approach, and then I will go to the sum of the individual congenital heart disease, basically acyanotic congenital heart disease to start with. And sometime after that, maybe we will have a break, as Nikhil suggested. So I will start with an individual congenital heart disease. Here, basically, you are looking at acyanotic heart disease, and many of them are basically intervened rather than surgicalized. So there may be, I will limit myself to the simplest thing so that the later speaker will talk about the divisibility or whatever for this particular lesion, but some practical things we will definitely think. Of course, the simplest, the most common defect is a ventricular septal defect. The aims are very simple. You have to identify, you have to locate and see whether there are more than one VSD and additional lesion. Quantify the shunt, very important. Look for the presence of PH and pulmonary stenosis. And of course, the sizing of the ventricular septal defect. And we all know there are four types of VSDs. Perimembranous, usually called as a biotic. Outlet VSD, it is also called subpulmonic, subarterial, doubly cut. So, there are so many terms for outlet VSD, supracrystal. But I think you should stick to one term, that is outlet VSD. Then you have an inlet VSD, and you have a trabecular or a muscular VSD, four types. The most common, as you know very well, is a perimembranous ventricular septal defect. And this is the most common, very small to very large. You look for an aneurysm formation because that is good. And look for a malalignment, very, very important. When you find a large VSD, you look for a malaligned VSD in a parasternal long axis view. It means two things. One, it cannot close. You have to close at some point of time. Second, they can later on develop RV outflow obstruction, they can behave like a tetralogy anatomy. And of course, in a perimembranous VST, AR is not very common, but you should always look for an AR in this perimembranous VST. This is what we call as a parastinal long axis showing a subbiotic VST. And then the second type of VST is the outlet VST, which we call as subpulmonic VST, much less common, but very crucial to differentiate between subbiotic VST. Why? Because they don't close at all, and they can have a 5-7% chance of a aortic valve prolapse and AR. And if they develop a prolapse or AR, they are candidates for surgery and very, very unlikely to close this thing. And this is again, in this particular parastinal view, it is still subbiotic, but in a parastinal short axis, it is little lateral. It's at the sometime around 1 o'clock. So if you draw a clock, and if you find the aorta as a clock in the central, and the perimembranous VST will be basically at 1 o'clock position, 12 o'clock position maximum, whereas the subpulmonic VST will be at 1 o'clock position, just beneath the pulmonary valve. So it's very easy to pick up. So both will be subaortic in a parastinal long axis view, but parastinal short axis view will differentiate a perimembranous VST from a subpulmonic VST. And the third VST is less common, more posterior. Very simple, you know, basically if you do a subcostal or an apical for a chamber view, you go anterior tilt and posterior tilt. You see a VSD, you also see aorta, most likely perimembranous. You see a VSD and you don't see the aorta together, it's most likely a posterior VSD, which is a inlet VSD, and look for the AV valve attachment, and it is least likely to close, and then look for a LV to RA shunt also in an inlet VSD. This is an inlet VSD. You see a large VSD, but you don't see the aorta. It's the posteriorly placed ventricular septal defect. And the second most common VSD is the muscular VSD, which can be anterior, mid, or apical, and can be single or multiple. So you need a multiple scans of the interventricular septum at different planes. And look at the relationship, the moderator band also. And this is an apical VSD jet, which is relatively small. The only problem with this is that if you have multiple muscular VSDs, it is very difficult to measure these VSDs, so you may underestimate the shunt. So shunt assessment has to be by a different mechanism. Look at the LV, look at the LA aorta ratio. It's not ration, sorry. And B mode, LA and LV enlargement, large PA, and the VSD size, of course, especially in a perimembranous VSD. And this was the original thing, that is, you divide these VSDs into less than 5 to 10 and more than 10. But this is subject to grave error, actually, not great grave error, because it should be correlated to the age and the weight of the child. For example, a 3.5 millimeter small, so-called small VST in a newborn weighing 2.5 kilogram will have heart failure. And people will wonder why this small, so-called small VST developed a heart failure. So basically, you divide the VST into two subsets, restrictive VST, that is, the size is less than half of the aortic root of that particular child, and unrestrictive is basically more or less equal size of the aortic root with minimal or no IV gradient. And the classical division is this, that is, one-third of aortic root diameter of a VSD is less than one-third of the aortic root of that particular child, this small, and between one-third to two-third its aortic root is moderate, and more than two-third is large and is almost equal to aortic root. It is called an unrestrictive VSD, as you find in a tetralogy of Fallot. And the assessment of pH, you know very well, is by IV gradient and TR jet. More often done is the IV gradient. You can see the IV gradient in millimeter from the baseline, and this is the standard representation. And you know that you take the BP and the RV systolic pressure is equal to arm systolic BP minus IV gradient. And if there is no pulmonary stenosis, the RV systolic pressure is equal to PA systolic pressure. The basic thing is that IV gradient is inversely proportional to the PAH. High IV gradient, no PAH. Hardly any IV gradient, significant pulmonary hypertension. And look for additional lesions like a ductus, a coarctation, MR, AR, very important, and sometimes anomalous muscle bundle. See, what happens is that many times you will see a small VSD with shunting and you are very happy, you can explain the murmur, but you totally miss the double chambered right ventricle, which is actually the hemodynamically more important lesion. So that is a very important thing. Look for a double chambered right ventricle. And the surgical point of view, the size, the shunt, the location, malaligned and aortic valve situation, PAH, all these things are important to the surgeon. Then we come to the second most common congenital heart disease in the world. It is ASD, which can be of secondary type, primum type, sinus venosus, and very, very rarely coronary sinus type. And of course, the principles are to identify, quantify, assess the PAH, sizing the to device or not, which I think will not go into the detail because later on people will talk to you. But as you know very well, you have the paradoxical septal motion, RV volume overload, and you will find an OSTM second MASD generally in a four chamber view or a subcostal view. Probably the best view in a small infant would be a subcostal view where the sounds are vertical to the ASD. This is the 2D of a significant RV enlargement, and you can see two types of paradoxical septal motion. On your left hand side is a type A paradoxical septal motion, and your right hand side is a flat interventricular septum, which means a type B. There were times when, you know, in the early 90s when we were doing DM, these M-mode measurements were very, very important, probably less now, but still it is still useful to assess the sizing of the atrial septal defect. And you can see the two different type of OSTM second MASD, the one with hardly any superior margin and one with a very good margin, very obvious to the even to the beginner that it could be eminently divisible, which we will discuss by Shivashankar later, and you have a left-right shunt. And additional effects, very unusually, it is less common. Think of a PDA, ASD, VSD, or I mean PDA, VSD, valvar PS could be an important one. And left SVC is important because they have to, if they are going for a surgery, I think they have to cannulate left SVC also. Otherwise, you don't get a blood-free, a field for the surgeons. And PAH is assessed by the TR jet. And PS, you know, up to 30 millimeter gradient across the aortic valve can be normal for a large ASD. So this has a large ASD with a gradient of 33. Most likely it is a flow related gradient, not with a significant pulmonary size. And you have to categorize into a small, moderate and large, and look at the margins, the proximity to the various things, which we will not go into the detail. This obviously looks like a divisible lesion. And then another practical thing is that very important in current situation is that whenever you have an infant who has a moderate ASD and has severe PAH, significant PAH by TR, which is disproportionate, be very, very careful, very, very careful, because there may be an additional large PDA that may be the offender. Then there may be an additional coarctation, which could be the cause for a severe PAH. Or there may be distant multiple muscular VSDs, which you cannot pick up sometimes. And of course, any ASD, so-called ASD with PAH on echo report, be cautious that you should not miss a TAPVC. And nowadays, we are finding infants who come with a murmur with heart failure, and you have severe pulmonary hypertension, and you have around 6 or 8 millimeter OSTM second MASD, and basically that ASD is incidental. This is what we call as a severe PAH behaving like an idiopathic PAH with a coincidental atrial septal defect, which is one of the classification of a PAH in congenital heart disease, as you know very well. And primum ASD is the second commonest variety, where we are more interested in the AV valve attachment and the left AV valve abnormality and likely possibility of a pulmonary hypertension, and this is a standard ostium primum ASD. And sinus venosus ASD is very interesting because all the MOD and 2D findings of a secondary ASD with no obvious ASD, you think of a sinus venosus ASD. We very diligent in not missing a sinus venosus ASD by a very good subcostal view. This is a significant sinus venosus ASD. There is nothing like a small sinus venosus ASD. All sinus venosus ASDs are significant, should go to a surgeon. And ASD, the surgeon will invariably ask, will it go to my opponent, the other side? Majority will go. But if they are going to them, we should think of a mitral valve repair. Is it required? Are we dealing with a PAPVC? Are we dealing with a left SVC? So you must be very careful in cannulation. Atrioventricular septal defect, as you know, is classified into four types: partial, complete, and in between you have intermediate and isolated left VSD. This is a standard a large ostium primum ASD and an ostium inlet VSD. There are three different types you should know, Rastelli classification. Now the practical thing about this is that, simple thing is that, if you have a complete AVSD in a Down syndrome, it will be type A. Whereas non-syndromic atrioventricular septal defect will be type C. Now the importance is that in the type C will have additional complex lesions, whereas type A will be simple atrioventricular septal defect. So syndromic AVSD will do reasonably well in the surgery because they are simple lesions. Whereas non-syndromic, that is contrary to the expectation, non-syndromic atrioventricular septal defect may not do very well in the post-operative period. That is because they have additional and complex congenital heart disease. And mostly, as you could, this is very important for you in the practical, mostly it is a type A ASD, and PVOD is very common. You know the reasons. Then we will have PDA also, and then we will have a break. And aims basically to identify the size, the pH, and additional lesions, as you know, parasternal short axis view or a ductal view, what is called high parasternal view. Suprasternal view is also useful in identifying. Indirect identification is basically LA aortic ratio, large LAs, and direct is visualizing color Doppler, and differential diagnosis in a small PDA would be a coronary AV fistula. A large PDA DD would be an AP window, and a small PDA again, Al-Kappa, we will see later. And is it a PDA? Because to see the PDA, then the diastolic reversal and multiple views for differentiating AP window from a large PDA. This is a simple PDA in a parasternal short axis view. And your right hand side, you see a very tiny PDA flow without any murmur, what we call as a silent PDA, which need not be intervened. And this is a very interesting phenomenon. You see, this is a newborn baby, day one. You find the left-right shunt only is during diastole, because systolic pressure of aorta is equal to pulmonary pressure because of a no fall of the PA pressure. So there is no left-right shunt. You can only see. So, but in that baby, the PA diastolic pressure will be little less than the aortic diastolic pressure. So there is a gradient of 12 millimeter. So basically, in a newborn PDA, because of the elevated PA pressures, you find only flow only during diastole. Then the continuous flow occurs only after some time when there is both systolic flow as well as diastolic flow. Here again, you can see the gradient is not much, which means PA pressures have not become absolutely normal. So this is the standard PDA which you see in an older child or an infant, where there is a large aortopulmonary gradient, which means that the PA pressures have become normalized. And you have to identify the ductus, the sizing, the quantitation of shunt pH, and additional lesion. And this is based on the LV enlargement, bulging of the interatrial septum, and of course aortopulmonary gradient, which you see. The higher the aortopulmonary gradient, the less chance of having a pulmonary hypertension. And you know it's an indirect measure of the PA pressure. PA systolic pressure can be calculated from subtracting systolic gradient from arm systolic BP, and diastolic pressure can be calculated by subtracting diastolic gradient from arm diastolic pressure, which is done, and additional lesions can be there. Now, two major problems in a newborn is that one is a case of the missing PDA. Now, what happens is that you have a newborn who is sick, who is otherwise sick in the nursery, and you have a high volume pulse, and you look for a ductus, you don't see sometimes. You can be a very large ductus, you can simply miss sometimes. Because many times, as you know, we all do this echo in a newborn with many times with the portable machine, and the baby may be on ventilator or on high frequency ventilation, and you have to skim and then find, do the anatomical assessment. So you can miss a large ductus, hypertensive ductus, because PA pressure is equal to aortic pressure in the newborn. What happens is that you don't see a turbulence, so you can miss a PDA. Another is that PDA, sometimes a casual assessment of the PA will show you a PDA signal, which is actually, it's not a PDA, it is a duct-dependent condition where you are seeing, as I will later show you this the example of this compensatory ductus. Again, the surgeon will ask mentally, will it come to our side? Very less, because the standard institutions, you know, only 5% will go to the surgeon, 95% will go to the interventional cardiologist. And if it goes to the surgeon, they will have to look for additional problems to fix also. And the AP window also I will finish, because it is a DD of a large PDA. But thing is, it's very important. Clinically, it behaves like a large VSD with PH. So whenever you have seen a two-month-old baby with heart failure, PAH, and no VSD seen on echocardiography, think that, oh, am I dealing with an AP window? And this is sometimes you will find an AP window which can be eminently curable, very slippery character, and presents with infancy with heart failure and pulmonary hypertension. I hope this is the first moving picture. I hope it works. Yes, it works. You can see the defect in 2D, right? You can see it nicely. This is an AP window which is there, and we will try to show the color. That is this thing, and this is in color. So this is a huge AP window, because recently I almost missed an AP window and made a diagnosis of a severe pulmonary hypertension in a two-month-old baby. Both I and the parents were fortunate that the next visit, I very diligently applied my mind and picked up an AP window. I apologized to them, sent them for a surgery, and the baby is doing very well. And they are very thankful to me for having picked up this, better late than never, in an AP window. So at this point, with Nikhil's permission, we will have a break. So which means we have done two things. We have done, one is we have done a segmental approach. Then we have done the left to right shunts, right? Then we are, what we have left is a stenotic lesion, and then a major area of a cyanotic congenital heart disease. So let's have coffee.
Yes.
Questions? Yes. Questions? Maybe you can keep later, no?
Yes, sir. End of discussion. We can just write it down now.
Because I have no problem. If you have the inclination, I have no problem with the time.
We'll ask at the end of the discussion,
sir. Yes, yes, yes. So we have a break. Have a KitKat. Yes.
Is it still available? KitKat?
Yes, sir. It's still available.
Still available. Yes.
Hello.
Hello, sir.
Mute. Sir has muted himself.
Okay. Hello, sir.
Hello.
Hello, sir.
Nikhil, I think sir has muted himself.
Yeah, I spoke to him. He will come back. Wait one second. Hello, sir. Hello, sir. Sir, you are muted, sir. You can minimize, sir, that PPT.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Now you are unmuted.
Now what you do? What I do is PowerPoint. Where is that? Okay. Now you can see.
Yes, sir. You have to make it a slideshow, sir.
Yeah, slideshow. But you can hear me now.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You are unmuted, actually. Yes.
Okay. Now, shall we?
Yes, we can continue, sir. Yes.
Yeah. So now we come to stenotic lesions, where you have to identify the aortic stenosis and which is the substrate, because majority would be a bicuspid aortic valve. You have to quantify, you have to assess the valve area, additional lesions, and you know, you have the 4-chamber, 5-chamber view, suprasternal view. So many views can be useful in assessing the aortic stenosis. So it's a combination of factors, and we have, of course, M-mode, which will pick up a concentric LVH eccentricity index, sometimes asked in the examination, and aortic valve echoes, multiple echoes, and of course 2D visualized aortic valve movement, and quantify by Doppler. And this was a person, young child who had actually 7-year-old child who had a mild concentric LVH, because you know, adult it is 11 millimeter posterior wall, but it depends on the age of the child to see what is LVH by echo criteria. And you can see on your right hand side a doming of the aortic valve with a definite dilatation of the aortic roots, which is a very important aspect which we discussed some time back, aortopathy. And you have the standard gradient of 73 across the aortic valve, which makes it a severe aortic stenosis. And this is the standard Canadian classification for pediatric aortic stenosis. Trivial is less than 25 millimeter of mercury, P gradient across the valve, Doppler. Mild is 25 to 40, moderate is 40 to 70, and very severe is basically above 70. So the previous echo shows a severe valvar aortic stenosis. And naturally, we have to look at the substrate, whether it is valvar, subvalvar, supravalvar. And if it is a valvar, most likely bicuspid. But you should remember that some of the congenital aortic valve stenosis need not be always bicuspid. It can be the usual trileaflet. Nature of the valve is important. Aortic annulus measurement is very important, mainly because of future balloon valvotomy. And additional lesion, I think particularly coarctation, very important, PDA, VST. Bicuspid aortic valve can be an innocent bystander in a severe, many times I have found that infant with a severe coarctation, the only finding you get in a 2D echo will be a bicuspid aortic valve without AS or AR. And unless you do a very proper examination, you will miss a severe coarctation. And aortic stenosis in infancy will have heart failure, LV dysfunction, and PAH, that is very important. So whenever you have an infant with LV dysfunction, or whenever an infant below 3 months has severe pulmonary hypertension, don't be tempted to call it as severe idiopathic PH in an infant. Think of a obstruction on the left hand side, either aortic stenosis or a coarctation of aorta. So this this is an echo which showed, as you can see, a very large right atrium and a comparatively smallish right left side. So, and it had a systemic PA pressure. And this is another child who had basically a LV dysfunction, and one would be tempted to call it as a dilated cardiomyopathy. So both can be presentation of a severe aortic stenosis, very important. So whenever you have an infant below 3 months with a severe PAH, it cannot be PPH, and it has to be some problem with a left side obstruction or a TAPVC, whatever. And second point is, when an LV dysfunction, always think of a remediable lesion like coarctation or aortic stenosis. And for the surgeon, is very key is to locate the severity of AS and LV function, coexisting AR, because the choice of intervention may depend upon this. Then pulmonary stenosis is perhaps one of the easiest to diagnose. You have to identify, you have to quantify, and make a decision on management. And this is a relatively mild pulmonary stenosis. This is a very severe pulmonary stenosis, gradient of around 80 millimeter. And again, the classification of pulmonary stenosis is slightly different from that of an aortic stenosis. Trivial is up to 25, mild is up to 50, moderate would be 50 to 75. Generally, intervention is offered when the peak gradient is above 50 or 50, 60 maximum. Depends on the institution, and severe would be above 75 millimeter of mercury. Slight difference between AS and textbooks based on this. And morphology is very important, because, you know, pulmonary valve can be dysplastic, may not be amenable to a balloon. And an annulus assessment is important, post-synodic dilatation, and of course the quantification. Then another practical problem in assessing a critical PS in the newborn, they will come very sick with cyanosis, and there is always a chance of underestimation. What happens is that the PA pressure in the presence of a severe PS will still be very high. Two reasons. One, it will remain high in the newborn. Second, there will be invariably a PDA to try to help out the baby. So that PDA makes it PA pressures to be on the higher side. So gradient across the RVOT will be less. So you will underestimate the gradient. See, for example, you have a PDA. Suppose you have an RV pressure of 80 by 0, which is systemic pressure in a newborn. Systemic pressure in the newborn is 70, so it can be suprasystemic. Suppose the PA pressure is 50 by 33 because of a large PDA, and the gradient will be only 30, which is actually in the mild range. So you will be tempted to call it as a mild PS, but you will be surprised to find there is some cyanosis, sick child. So be very, 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 very careful not to underestimate the gradient in a sick neonate with suspected severe pulmonary stenosis. So because of RV dysfunction, because of PA pressure being high, so many things, because you can underestimate the gradient in a critical PS. Now, another very, very important thing, in terms of the very dangerous things for an echocardiographer, you can easily miss. You have to identify the nature of the segment, the quantification, presence of PAH, and of course additional lesion. And you know, this is the last window, very important window, that is suprasternal view is very, very important. Unless you are comfortable with the suprasternal view in an infant, don't let send the report away saying that normal echo and not. Be very, very careful about this. And you should have a very strong clinical suspicion. I still remember when, during my first year DM in Sri Chitra, there's one of the senior most consultants was doing a suspected coarctation. In between, he was palpating for the docile SPD send out. And I was wondering why this technology, because I was so new to this situation, why such a senior person is feeling for the docile SPD, because echo, I was thinking, everybody can see everything in an echo. Don't be that. You have a strong suspicion. And LVH on a 2D echo and associated bicuspid aortic valve is a very important clue. never ever let an infant or a child go away without a good suprasternal view. If you are not comfortable, you ask them to come back again after 4 weeks or so and take one more of your colleague. And that will be very helpful in picking up this. And whenever you have a newborn or a small infant with severe pulmonary hypertension, search for a coarctation. And this is, as you know, the standard suprasternal view showing a normal descending aortic velocity. And as you can see here is a color flow mapping of a very severe coarctation. You can see a little smallish isthmus, and you have another view of severe gradient, severe turbulence in the discrete coarctation, as you can see here. And this is a gradient across the coarctation. And this is a very important picture because it shows the gradient both in systole as well as in diastole. And the peak systolic gradient, as you can see, is more than 64 millimeter. That itself shows it is very severe. But the point is, very important point in the exam, is that they will show you this and ask you what is the phenomenon. You see, it is called the diastolic tailing. That is, the gradient is seen during diastole also. Whatever may be the gradient, if it is 24 or 25 or 30, whatever, if there is a diastolic gradient, it has to be severe coarctation, which means that the narrowing is significant even during diastole, so that there is a gradient, resting gradient across the, very important, the term diastolic tailing. It is another diastolic tailing. So you see, here the gradient, peak gradient, is only maximum 30, 34. You will think it, okay, it's fine, but it is actually severe coarctation because there is a diastolic tailing. Here there is both diastolic tailing as well as a big gradient, no problem. Here it is less of gradient, but because of the diastolic tailing of the gradient, you make sure that this is a person who needs intervention, and you decide on the discrete length, arch, and arch hypoplasia. Normal value for a descending aortic gradient is less than 20. Abnormal is above 20. Significant resting gradient is, peak systolic gradient is above 30, with or without a diastolic tailing. And special concerns about coarctation. Whenever you have a newborn with RDS severe PAH, you have to make sure that there is no coarctation. And coarctation with LV dysfunction, as you know very well, will masquerade as a dilated cardiomyopathy. And coarctation hiding behind a bicuspid valve. This can happen in a child. The child will come with a murmur, 1/6 murmur. Child is absolutely fine, and you have a bicuspid aortic valve with a trivial AS. And unless you do a coarct and look for a good suprasternal view, you can sometimes miss a coarctation. And incorrect alignment of the probe also can be very, very dangerous in missing a coarctation, especially if you are not very comfortable with your diagnosis in the newborn nursery. You tell the nursery people that I'm not very comfortable, I will come back again tomorrow, have a repeat echo. As you can see, LV dysfunction with coarctation. And now this is another practical point, that is, whenever you have a child or an infant with LVH, with LV dysfunction, think of coarctation. LVH should be there. With LV dysfunction, think of coarctation, think of aortic stenosis, think of Pompe disease, and think of systemic hypertension. And you know, at least three of them are eminently remediable. Even Pompe can be managed with enzyme therapy. So don't call it as a simple LV dysfunction, possibly dilated cardiomyopathy. So this was another child with a severe TR who had a coarctation actually. So whenever you have a severe PAH, which cannot be explained by the shunt, what you call as, you think of an invisible window, especially AP window, and a large ductus, which I told you, and of course, coarctation of aorta, very, very, very important. And as you can see, this is another patient who had, and then combination can be there. Now, we come to perhaps the key aspect of echocardiography, because this is the key, that is, how to pick up a congenital cyanotic heart disease, and what is the defect, first question. Then, is this candidate, is candidate for a biventricular repair or a univentricular repair, which we discuss when we manage the surgery, and will it need a conduit and will it need a redo. All these questions has to be first answered by us, then only it should be given to the surgeon. So surgeon should be very important. So you should look at the congenital cyanotic heart disease with an eye of the surgeon, and for helping the surgeon to plan effective surgery. I think that is the key in congenital cyanotic heart disease, because majority of the acyanotic heart disease is done by interventionists, but all cyanotic heart disease will require a surgeon. And this was one of the second commonest congenital heart disease, but what you call as a very unique one, that is a transposition of great vessels. Atrioventricular concordance with ventriculoarterial concordance is the definition of a TGA. And, you know, basically all will require surgery. All cyanotic heart disease will require surgery. Each has a specific choice of surgical repair. But TGA has choices depending on the age of presentation and additional defect. So it is, for example, tetralogy, you make a diagnosis. You know, ICR, standard answer is ICR, or Schumacher repair for a supracardiac TAPVC. Whereas DTGA has choices depending on the age of diagnosis, the additional defect, the coronary anatomy, the echo anatomy. So it's a very crucial thing. And they have four types of a DTGA. The simple TGA is a DTGA with intact ventricular septum. Second one is a DTGA with a large VSD, not a small VSD, large VSD with pulmonary hypertension. Then DTGA with a large VSD with LV outflow obstruction, which will behave like an early fallow. And DTGA who will develop a PVOD and not operable. And Doppler, of course, is to make a diagnosis, delineate associated lesion, and make a decision on choice of surgical correction. Very, very important. So 10 years back, 15 years back, the question was diagnosis, associated defect, choice of surgery. Now it is actually the choice is ASO. So everything is primed towards candidacy of this patient for an ASO. That is one. And very important is the coronary artery pattern also. And you make a segmental approach. This is the classical example where the segmental approach will not fail you. You make a diagnosis of a AV concordance with VA discordance. Look at VSD, look at LV outflow obstruction, look at coronaries, look for any additional lesion and make a decision. And best views are subcostal, apical, parasternal short axis. But I think almost all the findings can be picked up by a very good subcostal view. So you identify the same thing, you know, a segmental approach. And this, see, this is a very practical thing. It's a red herring. That is, one of our teachers, Dr. Ramakrishna Pillai, used to tell me when I was a student that Sulfika, see, a TGA has two normal atria, two normal ventricles, and two normal great vessels. Everything will be normal. But there is a twist at the tail. So if you miss it, you are missing a transposition of great arteries. And this is a four-chamber view of a TGA. You can see a small ASD. That's all, nothing more with this patient. And this is again another view showing a small atrial septal defect. And here you will find a that was actually a intercirculatory mixing at the atrial level, and this shows a posterior ventricle. Posterior ventricle giving rise to a vessel which is flaring. The flaring vessel is actually the pulmonary artery. So pulmonary artery is arising from the posterior ventricle. I hope it moves. Yes. So you can see the movement. You have the anterior ventricle, large posterior ventricle giving rise to pulmonary artery. Then again, I will try another one. Yeah, this is much better. You have the posterior ventricle giving rise to a flaring vessel. So flaring vessel is PA, anterior ventricle is right ventricle. So anterior ventricle should be giving rise to aorta. You can see it here. See, you can see both the vessels, and anterior ventricle is giving rise to aorta. And this is again another picture of the see, both great vessels can be seen. Again, the most important thing is the posterior ventricle is giving rise to a vessel. So it is a ventricular-arterial discordance. And look at the associated defects like VASD, VSD ductus, LVOT obstruction. It is called pulmonary stenosis, and coronary arteries also are very, very important. And you know, basic, oh, it's a problem. Your status is set to do not disturb you only.
Any problem, sir?
Yeah, I cannot. The PowerPoint has disappeared.
Okay, sir. Again, you can share, sir. No problem.
Share. Ah, varunnu.
Varunnu.
It's coming. Can see now? Can you see?
No, sir. Not yet. Not yet, sir.
PowerPoint, you cannot see.
No, sir.
No. I see. When I share. Now?
Yes, sir. Now we can.
Yes, sir. Now we can.
You can see. Okay. So you'll have to move. Okay, so what happens is that the differential diagnosis will be, for example, you can have a near normal echo study, and then there's another differential diagnosis is a tossing being anomaly, and this is a VSD with a TGA, and See, this is a heart disease where you pick up a small PDA in the pulmonary artery, and you may be tempted to call it as a small PDA in the newborn. See, it is simply a pulmonary artery with a PDA, but if you are not very careful, you will miss a TGA. This is actually a transposition with a duct-dependent situation. So, if you miss transposition, a baby is in great trouble. And if there is a PDA, you have to start with a PGE1, and ASD also size has to be assessed to as doing for a balloon atrial septostomy. Aortic anomalies are important in a TGA, very important. Sometimes we are very happy that you have made a diagnosis of a TGA, looked at the ASD, looked at LVOT obstruction, and you are very happy, and finally you can miss a arch interruption. And hypoplastic arch, then the surgeon and we'll have to do a simultaneous repair also. Give me 1 minute, Nikhil. And you can have a VSD with the LVOT obstruction 30%, which will be like a tetralogy of Fallot. And very importantly, very, very importantly for an arterial switch is the coronary artery anomaly assessment. And it can be a very sensitive and a very accurate prediction if you do it very well. You may not require an angiography. The basic thing is simple practical thing. One, you have to visualize two separate origin of LCA and RCA. If that itself shows you reasonable confidence that there is not a major problem. And then you have to look at the LCA and see whether there is a division, whether LCA divides into LAD and circumflex. 90% of the job is done. And then, of course, no coronary artery between PA root and mitral valve in the short axis. And we'll make sure that there is normal coronary artery anatomy. The first two things are very important. And you can see a pulmonary artery, aorta, which is anterior, giving rise to an LCA, which divides into two. So you are reasonably comfortable there is a normal anatomy. Then LV parameters are important when they come late, because you have to decide whether the patient is still fit enough or LV is still good enough to have take up the aorta. And LV function can be assessed by various methods, which is a long discussion. And so finally, the echo Doppler decides before 3 weeks, ASO has to be planned, but look for a coronary artery pattern, VSD, LVOT obstruction. Whereas beyond 3 weeks, the question is whether ASO or sending, and then you have to look for LV function pattern, VSD, and then decide can we still do an arterial switch operation, because that is the optimal this thing. Now there is a gentleman from, we saw two gentlemen from Lund, and this is another gentleman, Fallot, who came from Marseille, France, and he diagnosed tetralogy of Fallot, and it's a roadmap of evaluating tetralogy of Fallot, basic clinical details, segmental approach, identify and characterize four components of tetralogy of Fallot, what I call as a tetra components, and additional anomalies, and some measurements also are important. And you know, tetralogy has a large malaligned perimembranous VSD. RV outflow is narrow with a small annulus and PA. Aortic override with aortic root dilatation and RVH. These are the four echocardiographic components of a tetralogy of Fallot. And the primary VSD is perimembranous, malaligned, unrestrictive, and sometimes can have an inlet or a subpulmonic extension. You should also look for an additional muscular VSD bar color scale adjustment, because the RV pressure is equal to LV pressure. And look at the flow across the VSD, whether it is right to left or left to right. And you can see a classical parasternal long axis view showing a large VSD with an override, which I will show you later. The second is a RV type obstruction. The level of obstruction, infundibular, valvar, supravalvar, degree, severe individual contribution, and presence of an anti-grade flow, especially in an adult tetralogy of Fallot without any much murmur. Infundibulum is almost always affected. Valvar can be present associated, and supravalvar also can be present. And this is another view showing both infundibular and the valvar septum. The pulmonary trunks are small. Trunk is small and there is a narrow annulus also. And there is a gradient, significant gradient across the RV outflow, which shows pulmonary stenosis. And the blood flows from the right ventricle across the VSD into the aorta. So it is a right to left shunt. And then very crucial thing for a echo assessment in a tetralogy is the PA anatomy, the PA annulus, bifurcation and confluence, the PA size, both RPA and LPA. This has to be measured. So you identify MPA, RPA, LPA and measure all these things. And this is how you measure. And that is, you take the pulmonary artery, the annulus, then the confluence, that is between three vessels, then measure RPA and LPA at its origin using various views. RPA can be easily assessed by suprasternal view, short axis. LPA needs little. LPA is basically parasternal short axis, and you can measure this. And aortic override. That is how you diagnose aortic override, is that if an imaginary line is drawn perpendicular to the long axis of the heart from the crest of interventricular septum, it will transect the cusp of aortic valve and extend to the root. I'll show you this. See, this is the parasternal short axis view. Take the, you see the VSD long axis, and it goes directly into the aorta. So 50% aortic override, which means aorta seems to be arising 50% from the RV and 50% from the LV, which is otherwise called the, some people call aortic override as a biventricular origin of aorta. So aorta appears to be originating from both RV and LV. And look at the aortomitral continuity, because that is the only finding in echo which shows you whether it is a tetralogy of Fallot or a double outlet right ventricle, because you have an aortomitral continuity, it is a TOF. If there is no aortomitral continuity, there is a cornus, it is a double outlet right ventricle. As you can see, the normally in the top, you have a normal aortomitral continuity. The posterior wall of the aorta continues as the anterior mitral leaflet. On your left hand side in a tetralogy, you find the posterior wall of the aorta continuing as the mitral leaflet. Whereas, as you can see on your right hand side, there is a tissue between the posterior wall of the aorta and the AML. And there's a long distance between this two that we call as aortomitral discontinuity, the hallmark of a double outlet right ventricle. And of course, look for an additional ASD. PFO is present in 50%, ASD is present in 15%, what we call as a pentology of Fallot. Coronary anomalies in 5%, and right arch, of course, in 25%. And coronaries can also be abnormal. Both are vulnerable to right ventriculotomy and transannular patch. But fortunately, nowadays, the surgery is done by the right atriotomy, and the surgeons are less and less inclined on transannular patch. And color flow mapping will tell you whether it's a right to left shunt, RVOT obstruction, map cast, all these things will be known. And there are TOF variants. This is a situation where you have significant RVOT obstruction with PR, which we call as an absent pulmonary valve syndrome. And I will see whether it moves. Hopefully it moves. Yes, there is a very narrow annulus, and there is an anterograde flow, and a PR flow. I'm sorry about this. And now the point is, clinically, if you find a cyanotic congenital heart disease with a systolic or diastolic murmur, one candidate as the one is the absent pulmonary valve. Another candidate is a truncus arteriosus. And the third is a post-operative tetralogy of Fallot. This can be asked in the clinical exam also. So this is a post-operative Fallot with both some residual obstruction with a significant PR. Now, this is a baby who had failure with a tinge of cyanosis, 88% saturation, and you think of a TAPVC, You look for a significant RV ileum overload, inability to image pulmonary vein entering LA, small LA and small LV, ASD with a right to left shunting, and echo-free space behind the LA, which is actually a confluence of the pulmonary vein. So you have a paradoxical septal motion, severe pulmonary hypertension, smallish LA, smallish LV, and the channel behind the LA. Think of this thing. So initial echo findings of a TAPVC will be RV volume overload, small LA, small LV, ASD with right to left shunting with PAH, and inability to visualize the pulmonary veins. See, it is, we call it as a bald LA, just like we call the EMF RV as a bald RV. This is a bald LA. Think of a TAPVC. And identify the pulmonary veins in the confluence, which can be ascending mostly, sometimes it can be descending, like in an infracardiac TAPVC, and it is very difficult sometimes to pick up an infracardiac TAPVC. And so identification of pulmonary vein, trace them to common pulmonary vein, and see the vertical vein, and see the obstruction, all those things need to be done in here. So generally, in a TAPVC, intracardiac TAPVC, pulmonary venous confluence is posterior to the left atrium, mostly going into the coronary sinus. Supracardiac veins is posterior and superior to the left atrium. Infracardiac is inferior to the left atrium. So this is a simple view where there is a posterior channel when we suspect a supracardiac TAPVC, and you have what you call as a severe pulmonary hypertension with severe TR. And you can still see a channel behind the small LA, and you strongly suspect a TAPVC. And there is a bad, and then you will see this picture. You will see inside this is the aorta, but on your laterally, you can see a lot of blue thing coming into a innominate and superior vena cava junction. And this again is another view where it shows a vertical vein going on to your right side. This is the vertical vein going and turning blue because it is going away from the suprasternal view into the innominate or a superior vena cava. It's a supracardiac TAPVC. So the basic point is that exclusive right to left shunting at the atrial level has to be abnormal, and it is strongly suspected to be a total anomalous pulmonary venous connection. And whenever you have a dilated coronary sinus and suspected TAPVC, this is most likely an intracardiac TAPVC and the most satisfactory result with the surgeons. So this was a huge coronary sinus, and there was a flow into the right atrium through the coronary sinus and into the right ventricle. This was an intracardiac TAPVC. And this is the infracardiac TAPVC, very difficult sometimes to pick up because there is 90% obstruction, so the flow may not be very prominent, but severe TR will be there, very severe PA, suprasystemic PA pressures. And this picture, I think you should know thoroughly, that is, you have a subcostal view and you have the spine, you know, IVC on to the right side, aorta is to the left, which you have seen when you assess the situs. But then in a suspected TAPVC, sick baby, you will find one more channel between the IVC and the aorta, a dilated venous channel inside the liver, that is very important, along with an IVC and the aorta. And then you think it is you have to start thinking that this is going to be an infracardiac TAPVC. So all the TAPVC clues with suprasystemic PA pressure, with this picture, you think this is an infracardiac TAPVC, and this is a common pulmonary vein anterior and to the left of IVC. So there are two things which you normally see, IVC and aorta, and I'm going to show you the real thing and you will understand this is the situation. You can go back to the picture. You see the spine, IVC to the right, aorta to the left, and central, slightly to the left of IVC, is the channel, that is the common pulmonary venous channel. This is the diagnosis of a infracardiac TAPVC. And of course, you will find sometimes you will find a turbulence here because of an obstruction very severe obstruction. Sometimes you may not even get a turbulence because it is a total, near total obstruction. And these are the common pulmonary veins. But this is a, this inside the liver. I think particularly mark this point. This is very, very important to make a diagnosis. And when in doubt, call in one of your colleagues, seniors, make sure that it's an infracardiac TAPVC. Even suspecting an infracardiac TAPVC is good enough for a newborn baby from your side, especially when you are a young cardiologist. So pitfall would be a so-called ASD in infancy with heart failure, PPHN in the newborn, and non-identification of the mixed TAP is sometimes very difficult. And then we come to another diagnosis, is a tricuspid atresia, and you know, basically atretic tricuspid valve on the right side. And I don't know whether it will move. It is moving. It is a atretic tricuspid valve, and you have to identify the VSD, pulmonary stenosis. The VSD, of course, will be a restrictive ESD. Now we have another exotic disease called the Epstein, paradoxical IVS, you will find, and the mitral valve closure, tricuspid valve closure distance will be more than 60 millisecond in an M mode. It used to be a very important question previously, now it's no longer very important. But very important is that tricuspid valve displacement, should diagnostic displacement is more than 8 millimeter per meter square. That is very important. You know, adult is around 1.7, 10-year-old child is around 1 meter square. So above 8 millimeter in a 10-year-old child is a significant Epstein anomaly. And you have a RV volume overload. There is an atrialized right ventricle with a displaced tricuspid valve. And you will find hopefully you will find this. There's a problem. This is something different. Anyway, the basic issue is missing the displaced STL and differentiation with an RV EMF. I think this will show, hopefully. Yes, this is a 2D picture of an Epstein anomaly, gross displacement, and you can see nicely the three compartments, pure right, the comparatively smallish pure right ventricle, and this is another view. Again, displaced tricuspid valve, and you will have a low pressure TR will be there across the displaced STL. And now another very important condition is an LTGA. ECHO is the diagnostic procedure of choice. But basically, this is actually the epitome of a sequential segmental approach where you have AV discordance with a VA discordance. And you have to confirm the diagnosis, look for the presence of a defect, look for the presence of pulmonary stenosis, look at the left AV valve, which is actually the tricuspid valve, and the rest of the other abnormalities. And this is a very classical picture of a LTGA, where you have a morphological right atrium is connected to the morphological left ventricle, and you can see a definite pulmonary vein entering into a left atrium, which is connected to a tricuspid valve, which goes into the right ventricle. Very classical of an LTGA. And hopefully this moves. Yeah, you can see AV discordance. You can see the AV discordance. And here is another patient, this patient who has AV discordance, and the tricuspid valve is much displaced. So this is what is called as an Epstein anomaly. So Epstein anomaly can occur in an LTGA. So another standard question asked in the examination is that, which are the conditions where you will get an Epstein anomaly? One is Epstein anomaly itself. Second is LTGA. Third is pulmonary atresia with intact ventricular septum. You can have an Epstein anomaly of the tricuspid valve. And here again, LTGA. with a severe significant GR. You will get very unusual feature. And this is pulmonary artery coming from the left ventricle. You have to believe me. Then this is the anterior aorta. And then truncus, I told you some time back, both have large VSDs, both have two good ventricles, both have a large aorta with an inverted comma, and both one valve cannot be seen. So sometimes very difficult to differentiate between a truncus and the pulmonary atresia, and sometimes you are very lucky. And this is a picture which shows a truncus arteriosus. Be very careful. You can see one big trunk, and you can see the VSD also, and posteriorly there is one channel going. So it's a type 1 truncus arteriosus. You can see that. See, this is the truncus, and this is the pulmonary artery arising from the posteriorly from the this truncus. Single ventricle, the basic decision is to see whether dominant ventricle is there or not, what is a great vessel relationship, and whether are we dealing with a PA situation or a pulmonary hypertension situation. This is actually a single inlet into a single ventricle of a RV morphology. It's not good to have a RV morphology. Then this is another very interesting thing, you know, cyanotic congenital heart disease, clinically normal CVS, apparently normal X-ray ECG, no right left shunt inside the echo, and then inside the heart in echocardiography, you may have to think of a methemoglobinemia or a pulmonary AV fistula, and you have to do a contrast echocardiography. And please watch this very carefully, whether it moves or not is another question, but you see this. See, contrast echo is being done. Again, watch again. One cycle, two cycle, third cycle, it appears into the left atrium. Once more, you can see. One, two, three. The third cycle, it is filling. So it is basically a pulmonary AV fistula. Otherwise, if it was an ASD Eisenmenger or a VSD Eisenmenger, it would have filled immediately. So after third cycle, cardiac cycle, it fills. So this is a pulmonary AV fistula, which can be kept as one of your spotters in the VIVA, pulmonary AV fistula. Another very important problem, which we already discussed, that is LV dysfunction. You should think of three conditions: Alcapa, coarctation, and aortic stenosis. Coarctation, aortic stenosis, I already covered. Alcapa, very important thing is look at the age of the child, below 6 months. RCA enlargement on echo, and the LCA origin cannot be seen. Think of this thing. So four important practical thing on echo would be impaired LV function, mitral regurgitation, normal origin large RCA, and uncertain LCA origin. You will see. See, for example, this is a poor LV, definitely a global dysfunction. Now you will find a significant mitral regurgitation. Then you will find that you have a very prominent right coronary artery, and you cannot nicely see the left coronary artery. Then you will find difficult to find a left coronary artery. And then there may be other findings which we will see. Now you see, this is a simple 2D. This is the aorta. This is the anterior pulmonary artery, which is giving rise to the left coronary artery, which divides into its branches. So left mainstem is from the PA, branches normally and very near the aorta and the left sinus. And that is that. The most important thing, that is very, very important thing, is that the blood flows from LCA to the pulmonary trunk. So it's a red flow. Very, very important thing. In this, you will see it here. This is a still picture showing you on your left hand side the standard pulmonary artery dividing, giving rise to a LCA, and the blood going into the pulmonary artery from the aorta. And that is the picture. And and hope this will move. Yeah, it is moving nicely, and this will hopefully show you the color flow. This has to be there to make sure that you are dealing with the PDA. You have to make sure that the flow is actually from the coronary artery into the pulmonary artery. Very, very, very important thing to look for. Yeah, so you can see nicely. You can see very nicely. This is the ultimate. This is, you know, these are all very difficult. Diagnosing TAPVC, diagnosing infracardiac TAPVC, diagnosing AL-CAPA, they're all very difficult for any cardiologist for that matter. And the only thing is, be on the lookout for this, and you will less likely to miss all these conditions. That's all I can promise you, because all of us have missed all these things at some point of time in our life. So this is the continuous diastolic flow entering the PA trunk. So this is a roadmap for AL-CAPA. You do an echo, LV dysfunction with MR. Don't brand it as DCM. RCA is dilated, cannot trace LMCA. Visualize LMCA from PA trunk. Visualize the retrograde flow, and it is AL-CAPA. And it is an eminently remediable condition. So this is again a figure of 10, which you can later on read. And this is one baby. I got a picture from my colleague. And this is basically aortic interruption, which can present with a shock. So one of the important causes of shock would be HLHS and aortic interruption. But this is another baby, very interesting baby, who had come with shock and been diagnosed an HLHS initially clinically based, but actually it was a huge mass. I don't know why this. It's possibly a rhabdomyoma, but the baby unfortunately died because of shock. Huge mass inside the left ventricle. So that is that. Then you know the red herring, a clue or a piece of information which is intended to mislead you, and you have to avoid these red herrings in an echo. I told you about an anticipatory and a detective echo in the beginning itself, and be very careful in committing PPHN in the newborn, because severe PAH, which could be due to, as I told you already, demonstrated to you, like critical coarctation, huge PDA, and an obstructed TAPVC. And coarctation, very important. Presence of bicuspid aorta will make you make sure that you do a good suprasternal view and carefully map out the envelope also. See, this is an envelope of a coarctation. And if you see only the more wider thing and measure that, you will underestimate the coarctation gradient, and you will not diagnose the coarctation. TAPVC is sometimes referred as HLHS. It's again, then I told you about the small, it looks like a small PDA, but it is actually a TGA, which is surviving on a PDA. And I told you about hidden agenda, bicuspid aortic valve. The hidden agenda is coarctation. Congenital MR, many patients I have seen with coarctation. Apical VST may also have a huge PDA. Tiny PDA would be a duct-dependent congenital critical heart disease. So the mistakes I have made across my career is some of them are non-critical. They are okay, because if I miss, somebody else will pick up, like missing a sinus venosus, ASD, mistaking coronary AV fistula for a coronary artery lesion because both are dilated coronaries, underestimating coarctation gradients, undecided on truncus versus PA. That happens to many people, even senior people. But these are the mistakes which I have made, which is not a very good thing. We can miss TAPVC, especially infracardiac. Once in a while, you can miss TGA in the newborn because, you know, I told you two atria, normal ventricle, normal great vessels, and only the twist in the tail, and missing critical coarctation, missing AL-CAPA, and almost, I told you, almost missing an AP window 2 months back, or 2 or 3 months back. So finally, the diagnosis, this is actually from Perloff. The diagnosis of a congenital heart disease represents the epitome of an applied clinical logic. When correct inference are drawn from accurate observation, diagnoses are made with gratifying frequency. He was talking about clinical diagnosis or clinical recognition of congenital heart disease, but I think it is true of echocardiography in congenital heart disease also. And this is the one website which sometimes you may find some I mean, this is our website where you have some PowerPoint presentation which you can access, because I have a feeling that this may be our last academic interaction. And I am also grateful to Dr. Deepa Kumar from Chitra, Shine Kumar from AIIMS, and Arun from Chitra. All of them happen to be my students, and they are big cardiologists now looking after small kids. And for their, some of the pixels have been borrowed from them. And thank you very much, and may the peace and the force be with you in your virtual DNB practical examination. Thank you very much.
Hello sir, that was a great talk, I think. Thank you sir, any more movement? Yes sir. Echo is coming. Any device is on, sir, in your side, mobile or
means
if you have kept laptop or mobile on, sir, then echo is happening.
No, nothing, only laptop.
Oh, is it? Okay. No, there is nothing there.
Echo is coming, but I can hear you very well.
Okay, sir. Nothing, sir. That was a great talk, sir.
Sorry, I wanted to say.
Thank you.
I think this might be the last class, sir. We have covered all the internet.
We have become great, colleagues, right?
Yes, sir.
Very good to know that. And
sir, I have doubt, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, you mentioned in PAH in the presence of ASD, you have to suspect whether there is associated primary PAH or coarctation of aorta, sir. Why coarctation will cause PAH?
No, basically, severe coarctation will produce naturally significant LV dysfunction. So it is basically a simple case of a left heart disease leading to severe pulmonary hypertension. The only thing is, in the newborn, what happens is that abruptly the PDA was is acting in a very critical coarctation as a sort of a savior. And suddenly on the second day, third day, you have an acute abrupt closure of ductus. It is like an acute MR happening to your adult patient. And there is an absolute increase in the afterload, and you have acute onset of LV dysfunction, which will tremendously increase, especially with an MR and all, increase the PAH. And you find
that it will be, LV will be decompressed now, sir.
See, another interesting thing is what I have seen. I have no reason, I have no explanation for that. We have seen both severe coarctation with severe PAH and severe aortic stenosis with significant PAH. But somehow what we have seen in infancy, very small infant, PAH with coarctation is more dominating. So much so, any newborn baby up to 1 month or so, if you have severe PAH, before committing on idiopathic PAH or a PPHN, we are very careful to look out for these two things. Second thing is, another practical point I will tell you is that ALCAPA, you expect LV dysfunction. It's nothing to do with PAH. ALCAPA, you expect the LV dysfunction when the PA pressure fall. Why? Because there has to be a reverse Robin Hood effect, steel phenomenon, right? So, but I have seen the youngest ALCAPA presenting with LV dysfunction, I have seen on 14th day, which is very, very unusual. So always expect the, what you call as unexpected. And these three things, severe pH in the newborn, always think of coarctation, critical aortic stenosis, multiple muscular VSD, and obstructed TAPAC. So if you rule out these four of them and tell your neonatologist, see, I am comfortable with these four exclusion, you go ahead and manage it as PPHM. Then they will manage it very well. But once in a while, you make mistakes. That is always there.
Okay, sir. Another, this PDA with critical PS, yes, they become cyanotic, sir?
Yeah, naturally. Because they will have severe PS, RV pressure will be suprasystemic. So naturally, RV EDP will go up to 10-15, which will cross the LA mean pressure. So invariably, there will be significant cyanosis. That is why PDA remains open, no? To maintain some sort of balance to the force.
Sir, that in abstinence, that ATS, MTS...
It has happened to me, because immediately after post-DM, we had one baby, again had a sick baby, cyanosed, mild cyanosed actually, very sick baby, severe RVH with TR. So we thought of actually TAPVC and all, and there was no TAPVC. The RA and RV were very big, LA and LB were very small. But aorta was normal, so no HLHS. And there was a ductus shunting from, predominantly shunting from left to right. And there was a gradient across the pulmonary valve, about 30. So 30, I thought this is very mild. But then I spoke with my one of my team. That was just after first year after my finishing my DM. So usually I call one of my seniors, my professors in Sri Chitra. So I called him up and said, sir, this is what has happened. What shall I do? He said, Zulfi, one thing is that it is most likely going to be a critical pulmonary stenosis because, so he gave me the reasons which I told you in a particular slide, and that was actually that. But because next time, what has happened was PDA was becoming closing and the gradient shot up to 40, 45 and on. So critical PS can be under assessed and they will have cyanosis. So whenever you have a cyanosis and you feel the PS is only mild, be very careful. Similarly, you have LV dysfunction, coarctation is only mild, be very careful. But diastolic tailing, I think, is very, very useful in a suprarational view in a suspected coarctation.
Sir, coarctation gradient more than 20 is considered or more than 30, sir, for sending for intervention.
I think peak Doppler gradient, peak gradient, see catheter gradient about 20. Right? Instantaneous peak gradient across this thing in Doppler is 30. 20 and 30. So peak gradient of more than 30 or catheter gradient more than 20 with upper limb hypertension is the definite indication for sending for an intervention. Sometimes you will have less than this value, but on exercise they can develop hypertension. That also will be a candidate for coarctation of, this is basically from a Canadian Cardiovascular Society guidelines on congenital heart disease.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Sir, the substance, ATS, MTS.
Another practical thing about this coarctation gradient, I will tell you, is that normally descending aortic gradient will be slightly more than the ascending aortic gradient because the size of the descending aorta is a little smaller. And if you have a large PDA, what happens is that if you have a large PDA, a lot of blood is going through the descending aorta. And you will get a gradient across the descending aorta as 15, 20, near 20 and all. So be very careful. In the presence of a large PDA, getting around 20 millimeter gradient, don't call it as a coarctation unless you see a shelf and all. It is basically because of a large flow across the descending aorta. Yeah, one question you asked me, I missed that question. What was that?
Abstinence, ATS and MTS distance 60 milliseconds.
That is the M mode. That is mitral valve closure. So you do see what happens is that In a normal parasternal long axis view, you don't see the tricuspid valve, right? ATL. You don't see. But if you go back and find one Epstein with and do a long axis view 2D, you will find both AML and ATLC. And you cut MO, you do an MO cut, and you will find you can measure the distance in MO. That is MO distance of between ATL and ATL. ATL and AML distance you can see. That used to be a very important question in the past, but nowadays nobody asks this question. But the other thing, that 8 millimeter thing is very important in 2D. So I think you should you know both, because one is an M-mode measurement, another is a, because that 60 millisecond means you are getting a wide split, you know. M-mode, it's basically M-1, T-1 distance. You are there only measuring.
Okay. S-1 split it mentioned.
Yeah, S-1 split. Yes, exactly. Correct. Absolutely. If you have a distance more than 60, what auscultatory finding that you will expect in Epstein? The answer is a split S1, correct. Okay, Nikhil?
Sir, intracardiac TAPVC will enter into portal vein, sir, hepatic vein, sir.
It can enter into portal vein, it can enter into inferior vena cava, and it can also enter into the hepatic vein, but very rarely, mostly into the portal vein or inferior vena cava. And it is crossing the diaphragm, no? So that is the major cause of obstruction, and it's coming down. So most difficult in an infant to diagnose will be infracardiac TAPVC, critical coarctation, ALCAPA. But the thing is, if you anticipate these things, you can suspect this and you can always get a second opinion. And that is very important. Always get a second opinion so that the baby gets the benefit.
Yes, sir. Anyone else? I think we have learned a great deal of pediatric cardiology, sir.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. I mean, 4-5 classes, I think we might have had, sir.
Yeah, I think 4.
Five, sir.
Hari has finished.
Hari Krishna has finished. Yeah, sir. Anyway, sir, thanks a lot, sir, for taking time, sir.
So keep in touch.
Thank you very much, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, so shall we leave?
And yeah, sir.
Best wishes, and let the Almighty keep you COVID free and free consultant. I mean, and all of you should become consultants after this exam.
Yes, sir. We will love to meet you also, sir. In some
Sir, definitely at some point of time.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
End with these slides. Click to next. Slower. This one.